Hello everyone, thank you for coming back after lunch. Can all I was going to say something. All be quiet, please. My voice is going now, you'll be sad to know, because I'm not going to be able to talk much this afternoon, so my voice is starting to go. But I hope you're enjoying it so far. We are in the last session of it. I wish it went on for another 4 days. Sharon doesn't, she's ready to go home, but I wish it were gone for another 4 days. We have a very special guest that's coming up next, but this guy here has been through hell and back, and he's up on stage because he's rewrote a famous song. And like all karaoke styles, we're going to put the words up there, and we will highlight on the camera anyone that isn't singing. So if you don't want to be on here, at least move your lips. Even the ones that can't talk, move your lips. Even laryngectomy patients, move your lips. Otherwise, you will be on camera, Chris. So Mo.
I'm ready when the boys are.
So are you ready to go? Let's rock with it.
Gotta go. With a treat, but now it's once every week. Take some pills just to help us survive. So many times it happens too fast. You need surgery early. Stay positive, cause there's no time to cry.
And that's how you beat cancer. That's a little bit special. So I'm so chuffed. We first met Mo realistically in Nottingham when he brought his mask, which is the one on there. That's his radiotherapy mask, and I was so impressed with it. And it's now part of our marketing for radiotherapy masks, and that goes all around the world. The amount of people that absolutely love that mask. We used to fetch it with us, but unfortunately it's looking as old as me these days and a bit tattered. That's why we took the picture and now started using it on there. So again, and I don't know whether you've seen Barbie and Ken, but that's our Barbie and Ken. If you go on Twitter, they have their own Twitter account. And to give you some history, Ken got cancer, throat cancer. He had his mask fitted at Northampton, and he had his feeding peg fitted in Blackpool, so he's got a feeding peg. So if you lift his shirt up, he's got a feeding peg, so have a look. He met Barbie in the waiting room, who was waiting for her operation, and now they're having a bit of a fling on Twitter. And the world is following Barbie and Ken, so I've been tweeting that they're here in the audience and they've got a room upstairs. What goes in that room stays in the room. But you can see him next door. So if you are next door and you get a chance, go and take a picture with Barbie and Ken. They've got a massive, big audience. So, and I use it in schools as well to explain. And Mr. Nigam, who's my surgeon, has promised me when he gets a chance, he'll put him on the table and actually do a neck dissection on him. So that's him. I'm going to hand over to Philip. Oh, no, I've got this. So we've been doing a competition. And the Twitter photo, have you got it up? Who's that up there? Tia, who's Tia? Come up here, Tia. Tia, are you a health professional? You're not allowed alcohol. You're not allowed to drink, and you don't look old enough to drink. But there you go. Thank you very much. So where's Philip? Philip. This one of the last times you'll see Ant and Dec on the stage. So I'll let you introduce our new guest. I'd love to introduce him, but I'm going to let you introduce him. And again, celebrities, it's the first year ever a celebrity have come out of their way to come in with us. So I'll leave
it's
you to
the least introduce. I could do.
Yeah.
But let's not talk about me. Our next... guest speaker is a man that I'm sure most if not all of you will know from TV, he's been a phenomenal chef for many years, and as we've talked a hell of a lot in the last couple of days, nutrition, taste, flavours, eating is, well, it's normal, so much part of normal life, so what you're going through is just all the help you can get. So I think Michael Caines is our speaker today, and he's going to talk about nutrition, taste, flavours. I think there's a film we've got before.
Right. If you want to, I will take the mic rather than the mic. Right. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for having me, and I've got I haven't really got a presentation on screen, but I've got some lovely pictures, so apparently if I click next, it'll come up. It's on that screen. Oh, my apologies.
We can see it though.
You can. It's just me. I can see it. Nutrition doesn't have to be boring. So apparently I'm going to bring the fun into your life. As a chef, I thought what I'd do is to share some of the secrets, talk a little bit about the challenges of making food tasty, but also take into account some of the challenges that your patients and some of you as patients have, because we take for granted something so simple as the enjoyment of eating. And that's it. Food should be fun. It should be nutritious, of course, but it should be tasty and enjoyable. Growing up, I grew up in a large family. I was adopted at the age of 6 years. Ode grew up in a family. I was the youngest of six. And we all got together around the table. So the food is social. It's very much about a sense of coming together. And as I grew up in around the family, we all had chores, didn't really like washing up, didn't want to hoover, certainly didn't want to do the washing. I grew a passion for food from a very young age, and my father used to grow vegetables. So we were out and about growing the vegetables, being into the home, and mum would turn them into what I would consider to be wholesome foods, lacking somewhat in flavour. Soap didn't really feature, vegetables were cooked far too long, and spices, they were an imaginative, exotic thing that didn't often grace our table. However, it was wholesome food, often grown from our garden, and simply braised and cooked into delicious meals. But I think the thing that I remember most isn't the detail of the cooking. It's the fact that we all got together as a community of a family, if you like, around the table, which forced us to talk to each other which is pretty tough when you've got five elderly brothers and sisters who insist on taking the mick out of you. So I guess when I think about food, food is more than just a need of sort of living to eat. So we say, in French they say, you live, you know, you eat to live. So food is more than that. And the French also say that it's the essence of life itself. They live to eat. They live to enjoy the food. It adds enjoyment to people's lives. It in itself is a cultural thing. I mean, you know, you think of great food, you think of great cultures. Food is at the center of that. If you're on holiday, you're always looking to seek out places where the locals go. Food is technical. It's something that requires a technical ability and a mastery of technique and, of course, an element of science. And above all, it represents getting together to enjoy life and also to celebrate and share. So it's a very social thing. But above all, for me, it's being able to provide a meal and enjoyment to people. And that's very difficult for people who have perhaps, as you know, have been set back by their own personal story of getting cancer and then having to work around those challenges with surgical operations that deny them the simple pleasure of enjoying food. So some of the focus is to how do we amplify flavour? How do we make food enjoyable? Of course, nutrition in diet is really important. But to make food, you've got to make it look attractive. So we've got to take an ingredient such as artichoke and turn it into, and mushrooms such as gyrol, base products, fish such as proteins such as turbot and truffle if you can afford it, fruit, veg, bananas. We make it look delicious, so something like a wholesome breakfast or wonderful salad can be simply look delicious and give appetite. But to enjoy food, you use all of your senses, including common sense, may I add, when you're in the kitchen. But you can look, it's got to be appetizing, you can smell it, but above all, you taste it. But all of those emotions come together. So if you're denied one of those things, food becomes very denying you a sense that of enjoyment. And so how do we get around that? How do we amplify taste? How can you take something that would be generally, you know, okay and elevate it into something that's incredible? So nutrition throughout treatment is important, but ultimately, I remember my own story was, you know, I was 25 years old, driving home on the motorway, fell asleep at the wheel, woke up in amongst a horrific car crash, lost my arm in the car crash, and ended up in hospital, losing my right arm. And when I was in hospital, it dawned on me that the food in hospital isn't particularly very good. And since my time in hospital, I spent some time working with the trust, or some trust, to try and make food sexy, I think, in hospitals. And then you realize the huge challenges you have. But one of the key things that came out of it was that, yes, it's important that you're healthy and you get nutrition, but if you're starving, you don't eat at all, you can't get the nutrients in, then actually, and also you can't get the enjoyment and pleasure out of eating food, then that's not going to help either. So we put a lot of focus on how do we make food taste good and how do we make it approachable for people that are under treatment. So that made us thinking about how we then think about some of the saliva issues that you've got. How do you make food easy to swallow? And it's more than just pureeing things, because you can puree up a soup, but if it's not seasoned, doesn't have any flavour to it, there's no enjoyment in that. That takes me back to my school meals, in fact, where you felt like, you know, you didn't want to eat it, and somebody shouting at you saying, think of all the kids in Africa, and you just think, well, me being obese isn't going to help them. But, but it was kind of nonsensical. And so food needs to have a purpose, it needs to have flavour. And it's a joke, but I obviously meant it in good faith. Food has to be more than the sum of the parts of nutrition. It needs to be flavoursome. And you've got to build up flavours. And to do that, it's an actual technical ability. You'll need to think about layering up flavours and using things like spice. And I talked earlier about aromatic spices. And spices, when we talk about spices, everybody thinks about bloody heat. And you think, you know, it's got chili in it. But no, when we talk about aromatic spices, we're talking about things like cumin, turmeric, spices like saffron and various other spices that elevate and layer up flavours. You're talking about using herbs. There are two types of herbs. There's herbs that are sort of more robust, and then there's green herbs at the end. If you add the green herb at the beginning, well, they lose most of its flavours. And we talk about using oils. essential oils. There's essential oils in everything, and you get more flavor imparting into food through oils or through fat than you will in anything else. So there's some very simple things that you can do to enhance your food by using particular techniques along the way. So when we talk about the art of flavor and working with good ingredients and building up flavors and creating different textures, this is where food becomes exciting. This is where I get excited. This is where I turn a simple salad or simple, I think this is pretty simple, but well-presented food into something more than just that. It becomes an art form. First of all, we eat with our eyes. We say, well, wow, that good. And secondly, you're probably smelling it. But if you're denied sight, then obviously people are telling you it looks good. You take it for granted. But when you smell it, immediately you're aroused. And then next expectation. With smell comes expectation. And then when you at first taste it, well, if it's tasty, it'll be moorish. And that's why we like to use that word. And when we present food, we can present it in a way that can be sharing. So this is where food becomes an art form, is when you take the ingredients and turn it into something that looks incredible. But ultimately, food without any depth of flavor, without any sense of purpose, becomes really just, for me, pointless. So how do we cook? How do we make something look so good in a hotel and turn it into something that is absolutely stunning? Well, we talked a little bit earlier about technique. When I think about food, I think about building up flavors. I think, well, okay, there's some things you can do. You start off with something simple as an onion. If you sweat an onion in oil, it's slightly different flavor profile than if you sweat it in butter. Butter emulsifies, so that means that when you blend it with something later, then it'll emulsify better if you sweat it in olive oil. The oil won't emulsify so easy. But also, when you're sweating your onion, your pinch of salt can make a world of difference. I'll talk a little bit about salt in a minute, because salt is, for a lot of people, oh, too much salt, you can't have salt. It's not a good thing, but actually salt is the salt of life in the kitchen, is through enhancing flavor. So a pinch of salt also draws out moisture. When you're sweating the onion, maybe put some garlic in there, and then you think about an element of spicing. If you're making a curry, you'd put your aromatic spices in, and you sweat it out at that point with your onion. And at that point, you can then start thinking about what else you're going to add, a stock. Now, water is just water, but when you add something to water, it becomes a solution, it becomes a stock. So if you've got onions sweating with garlic with some spice and some herbs, when you add the water, immediately you've got a tasty stock. So if you put your vegetables into that stock to cook, you're then going to have a delicious soup as opposed to a bland soup. And that's where we talk about layering up flavors. If you're having a stew and you seal off your meat, you'll get more flavor, more intensity from caramelization. And that simply by sealing off the meat enhances that. And we're thinking about eating, and you think about braising. If you chop up your meat small as a dice and then braise it, and then when that stew has been cooked, the textures and fibers of the meat will break down. And instead of trying to chew it, you just break it apart and put it back through the sauce, and you have something really, really delicious. So we talk about treatments and how it affects. I was listening to some of the patients saying that they can't swallow. And actually, that's a physical part of the enjoyment. It's not only the smell, but it's actually having it in your mouth and chewing it and being able to enjoy the texture of food and then being able to swallow it. And in itself, it gives you a sense of pleasure. And that means to say, if you're denied the ability to chew it and taste it through the smell through your nose, you're relying on flavor coming up from the base of your throat up through that way. And that was really interesting to me. I hadn't even considered that. So you need to perhaps elevate the food a little bit more by using some of these techniques. I've thought about this intensive, you know, food may taste differently before and especially during and after treatment. The treatment itself will make things bitter and change the metallical taste of it. So something as simple as understanding the difference between sweet, sour, salty sugar, heat and acidity, as in heat balanced with acidity or heat balanced with cream. These little techniques can simply help you navigate through some of those challenges and elevate your food. Food may taste differently, as we said before, but some foods may taste bland. You may lose a particular taste for a particular food, where others are more sensual. Food may also taste the same. They always say that everything tastes like chicken. It's a simple fact that actually chicken can taste very, very different because it's a good conduit for food. It can take on flavors. You can put it in a curry and it becomes something else. You can put it in a stew, put it with a cream sauce. It's actually a very, very easy way. But it doesn't break down as a texture very well. Whereas, you know, if you braise meat like beef or braise meat like lamb and let it braise very, 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 very long time, slowly cooked in the oven with vegetables, that will break down very, very easy. So In essence, to make food tasty, it's all about seasoning. So it elevates the flavour. It also aids the balance of electrolytes and also helps carry nutrients to cell and regulates the acidic base imbalance in your diet, supporting the transfer of nerve impulses and regulating blood pressure and secreting gastric acid. Now, I read that. I didn't know that until I searched it. They're all the good things that soap does. Too much soap can give you high blood pressure, heart disease, and stroke. But there again, life's too short, so let's focus on the good things that soap does. What it does is elevate flavour. If you put a pinch of soap, and where did the word soap come from? It came from the word salary, to sell. They used to give the Romans, used to get part of their pay in soap, because it was that precious for them to sprinkle a bit of soap in their food to elevate the flavours. So if you're using soap, you can also use elements with it. Soap always elevates flavour, so if you're using acidity, if you're seasoning it, it will elevate that. But soap also contributes to the balance of a dish. So if you talk about salty, sugary, we also talk about sweet and sour. So what we have, like zing and zen, they kind of go, it's a bit like Aunt Det, they kind of go together, but they're different. You know, if you've got sweet, you need acidity to help break through it. If you've got fattiness, you need a little bit of acidity to break through that as well. On the palate, you get that stickiness of the protein of fish. Lemon juice helps dissipate that. Heat, really strong heat. If you've got acidity, like in Thai cooking, they break it down with a little bit of lime acidity, or with, you know, curries, you get the heat, and then you have the creaminess. If you have a very, very hot chili, the first thing you want to go for is some yogurt, because that calms it right down. So when we're thinking about how do we use seasoning, knowing these things, the balancing act, I think, you know, when I'm thinking about how you do that, if you've got a metallical taste, then you, by simply adding something sweet, that'll balance it out. So for instance, something like maple syrup, agave and nectar, and something like a squeeze of lemon can help balance out that dish. And you, and also we're talking about butter and fat, that gives mouthfeel. So if you find it difficult to swallow and you haven't got saliva, having butter through finishing through your soups or finishing with cream gives the viscosity in the sauce and gives the smoothness and helps you digest and swallow. And if things taste too salty, because this sometimes happens, you can control that by a little bit of acidity, remember I said, you know, or sweetness too, just to bring that down and so that you can do that. So very, very simple. Acidity also with soap can control other flavours and elevate too. And, you know, if you don't want to do the sugar, you can add sweetener or natural sugar, things like honey or maple syrup. That acts really good too. Other things that I like to think about in food is a presentation, of course, but also the other thing I like to say is it's just simple, kind of almost kind of goes without saying, simple. If you start off with your protein, what are you going to serve it with? Well, the first thing to think about is the seasons, and then you think about the vegetable. But we put a lot of weight on a lot of protein, and one of the fish benefits of proteins that I think is really superb is fish. Fish is really high in omega. It's also easy to digest. You can mash it down and blend it. And I find that flaky fish such as salmon, cod, is very, very good, very nutritious and easy to cook and mix in into your food. Simple things like turning well-made soups out of vegetables into delicious meals can be simple as adding herbs in at the beginning and fresh herbs in at the end. For me, it's about layering up those flavours, as was taught. Spice isn't just about heat. It's about using those aromatic spices and also using the oil to extract out when you're sweating the onion, the garlic, and all those spices in that oil. When you blend it later into your soup, you'll have a huge amount of flavour. I often say to people, stick to plants, wherever plants are, and put them at the centre of your plates. And we've got a picture there, a lovely pigeon dish with the vegetable around the outside. But if you took away the pigeon, you'd have a beautiful plate of vegetables. But I often say, you know, a vegetable can taste incredibly boring, but if you cook it in some herbs and spices, it'll then suddenly become something very, very different. I say also, you know, the other opportunities I've written here is that you can roast vegetables. You know, if you take vegetables like root vegetables this time of year and put them in the oven and roast them with some garlic and, you know, some thyme, sage, those robust sort of herbs, roast them in the oven, then put them in a stock, vegetable stock, let it cook out, and then, of course, blend it. Or even if you just serve the roasted vegetable mashed up and bring it together. They can be delicious because when you roast your vegetables back through the oven with some herbs, you intensify the flavor. You're drying out the moisture, and then you really, really are intensifying the flavor. And then perhaps towards the end, not at the beginning, because if you're putting something in the oven at 80 degrees, towards the end, you know, add your spice 5 minutes before the end so you don't burn them, so you're controlling that. And I think the thing is, somebody said to me, while they were ill, they were watching a lot of cookery programs for inspiration to find out how to get flavor into their food. And they've since become really interested in food because they learned to discover that the spectrum of flavor is incredible when you start discovering spices and herbs and different styles of cooking. One of the things I've often said is pasta's great, but pasta isn't just bloody big penny. You can get really small, delicious pasta that make it a lot easier and easier, more approachable to eat. If you cut up your vegetables really, really small, you can have like a textured minestrone. And you can think of things like pho or bouillons or nice clear soups where you can almost get a minestrone effect, which make it tasty, give you an element of texture, but at the same time make it easy to digest and get loads of flavor in. And by simply adding herbs at the end or at the beginning into your cooking, you can really elevate and prolong the flavor of your food. And I think really when I talk about spices, I always think about persistence of flavor on the palate, which I think is really important. So when I'm thinking about proteins, I just think about why, you know, everybody thinks about steak. It's sometimes, even if it's not tough, the texture is very, very difficult. So think about braised meat, slow cooking, pulling off the meat off the bone, and then just shredding it down. But start off as a small dice so that you haven't got so much texture to have to deal with in the mouth. Fish, as I spoke, was absolutely fantastic. And also, just when I'm thinking about pasta, think about the size of the shells you can get. And also things like noodles, very soft noodles, easy to digest as well. I mean, as a chef, you know, the art of food, as I say, looks absolutely stunning. But ultimately, this is a little video that takes us from, we call it farm to plate. That's the art of cuisine. Now, I'm just going to finish up fight before we're going to have some questions, but I'm going to talk a little bit about adversity. Now, at 25 years old, I lost my arm in a car accident, and I'm now, you know, you can be kind, but I'm now 54. Anyway, the point is, I look back at 25, before I lost my arm and had a terrible car accident and had to face up to the new life. One of the things that I realized is that life changes very, very quickly, and it puts you on a new trajectory. And you can either, as somebody said, embrace that and be positive. I mean, I could have dwelled a lot on the fact that why was it me? You know, why did I fall asleep? Why? And there was a lot of whys in the start of my recovery. But after that, those whys turned to, well, what if, you know, I died that day and could have nearly lost my life, and the fact that I didn't, then, okay, so what can I do about my life and be more positive? And for me, food is the thing that got me through it. You know, my energy and my whole life has been consumed by my love for food and my ability to cook good food. And that's become the focus point. And very quickly, the first year was small steps. And I used to look back and think, this time last year I had two arms and my life was much different. It wasn't better. I don't think it was necessarily better. We liked the thick link. But I certainly appreciate life more now than I did before. And I used to think, for the first year it was all about looking back. And I used to think, well, my dreams, are a lot better than the nightmare of the life I live. But as a year went by, I looked back and thought, well, this time last year I was struggling. Look where I am now. And you realise that, through the support of friends, family and experts, you realise that actually things that are problematic initially become a new life, and then step by step you find the confidence, and also you find the company of others, the people who've been through it, and also those people that have spoken today and yesterday. They give you the courage and also their life story to help you get through and recover. And for me, the reason why I'm here today is because I can empathise with your challenges of dealing with adversity, and I commend all of you for your bravery, but also for your perseverance. Life is far too short, and my joy in life is being able to cook. But I also know that food and flavour brings a huge amount of enjoyment to people's lives. So, and this is an amazing scheme that Chris is introducing about, us being able to highlight restaurants where people can go and eat food more easily, and we're on board with that, and we're going to support that campaign and try and encourage other people to get on board with that. So I'm really, really pleased to have been here to speak to you today, and I'm going to allow you, if you have any questions about food or anything-ish, then I'm more than happy to answer them if I can. Thank you.
So you've got Anton Deck on the stage, so we have to stand this side. I'm not allowed to go that side. He's made it very clear I've got to stand that side to that side. So I'm going to let you go first because you're the most senior.
Very good. Mike, that was terrific. Surprising, not surprisingly terrific, but it's surprising and terrific from what you said. The adversity bit at the end was something different as well, but just taking on board all the things you can do to make life better. It is food and drink, and for so many people here, as very much a layperson who watched what was it, sort of Ainsley Harriet doing the when I should have been studying medical school. So that was my cooking experience. So I'm not the right person to give advice. But I think if there's so much to take on, it's been really terrific. Are there questions for Michael?
So I just got one comment before I come to the questions, because Anton Decker's like the double act. Do you not realise that yet?
Apology. I'll go back to the jungle.
Yeah, Michael mentioned about the restaurant card. I don't know whether everyone knows about the restaurant card. I've been banging on about this restaurant card for 7 years. And all I needed was someone to believe in it like I did in the industry of cooking. And when we got introduced to Michael, and I was so chuffed that he was going to come and just talk to us, I also took the opportunity to throw the restaurant card by him, never expecting him to pick it up and say yes. I thought he might have been very polite and give me the normal, yeah, of course it's a good idea, Chris, but and go away. But he didn't. He got hold of it. He's introduced us already to a couple of people that are now going to get hold of it and move it forward. And I can honestly say now that restaurant card is being launched. Not in the UK, which is strange to say that I've been banging on this for 7 years and one conversation with yourself and Pip and another one. And we're launching it in the Maldives. So
I make that.
There is a wonderful, wonderful holiday resort in the Maldives that deal with people that are disabled, and they embrace disability in their leisure facilities. And the CEO of that organization, when we spoke to them, said, we are going to now introduce that into the Maldives, and anyone that struggles with swallowing, they are going to ensure all their chefs and all their team understand that as a disability, and are going to make sure that they now launch it as part of their package to say, we deal with people that have swallowing issues and eating issues. So it is being launched, not here in the UK at the moment, but also I'm talking to Michael that what I need here in the UK is someone like Michael's restaurant to do an opening session, to do an opening of the restaurant card. Because I know if I can get Michael to stand there and say that he uses it in his restaurant, little Joey around the corner is going to say, if Michael can do it, we can do it. And in fact, we were at a tapas bar locally on Monday night after setup day, and I spoke to the owner, and I said, Michael's behind it. And his words were, if he's doing it, I want it in my restaurant. So he's going to launch it here in Torquay as well, just because Michael's name and his voice is behind the restaurant card. So I can genuinely say now, in 2024, at some point, at your restaurant, we are going to do a launch. Brilliant. Now, I can't invite you all, but we will be inviting patients because it's important patients come. And I would imagine at that particular do, caregivers won't mind coming. So, and we hope then that Michael's team will actually cook for us in the way it should be cooked. Not take it, I mean, I don't know, Sharon, I wonder if you're in this room, notice there's no gravy on the plate. There's no splashing around. When I get my tea served up, there's splashing around everywhere. But, you know, yours, the white tea. If we can do that with a restaurant card, I think it's going to help us all. The idea is that you'll be able to go into a restaurant and straight away from the minute you walk through that door, the waiters, the team will know you've got a problem with eating and swallowing. So you won't have to say like I used today, I've got cancer and this is the reason why I need to do it. You'll be able to walk in there. And the same as if you're a gluten-free person, they've got little symbols on. You will hopefully then be able to walk in that restaurant and see something on the menu, yet to be decided how we do it, that you can just say, I'm a head and neck patient, show him your card, and from that moment onwards, the chef, everybody knows they've got to do it differently. That will bring people out of their homes back into restaurants. It's not a big thing, it's 1%. But I've always said, if we change our journey by 1%, then it's 100% to us as a patient. And this is one big one. So I'm hoping that while the industry is struggling to get people to spend money and go into restaurants, this is another avenue to get people in. And if anybody wants to have an invite, you will be on a waiting list, I'm sure. But let me know and we'll put you on that list, because the invite will go to this room first. And I don't know, how many tables do you have in the restaurant?
Well, I'm starting to do a bit of 10. Oh, no, 10 covers is what we got. No. Yeah.
So there'll be a waiting list, but we will launch it with Michael's help. That is going to happen now, I'm glad to say. And I'm so chuffed that I've been able to announce it here. It will make a difference for so many patients, Michael. Mm. The mere fact that you put your name and your reputation behind it, no pressure, but it'll be good. Mm.
Good.
So that's what I would like to say, and I think you deserve a round of applause.
Thank you. I think it'd be easier than gluten-free, so yeah.
Yeah.
We had a question up there, didn't we?
The question.
Yeah, we haven't forgotten you, darling. Sorry, excuse me. Good, yeah.
Hi, Michael. My name's Corinne. I'm a speech and language therapist at Worcester Royal Hospital. Really interesting to hear that you're involved in the restaurant card scheme. That's fantastic. I was just wondering about whether you would ever consider putting some thoughts towards perhaps a recipe book or something, because I think the trouble is often people who are on modified texture diets, they end up eating either different things to their family, or it's just whatever they're having, it's just they ended up with something that's just been blended. But actually a lot of people find puree tastes quite different to the original meal. So actually, is there sort of any scope for looking at how you alter flavour so that sort of modified diet meals are more palatable and exciting?
And also presented, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, I mean, I think the answer goes is yes, that we can do some recipes, because actually that's good. I think probably to make it a bit more interesting, is probably need to understand the challenges behind the recipe, because if it's everything's got to be pureed, then I mean, you know, tasting menu is great, but a tasting menu of pureed food is going to be different. But at the end of the day, there's a reason why a record's 3.5 minutes long, because after that, it's just boring. There's a reason why if you chew chewing gum for more than a few minutes, it loses its peppermint. You know, you get bored of food quite quickly. So some of the simpler things you can do is just have varied flavors in your meal. So don't have a lot of the same thing, just have different flavour profiles. And that's one way of building up a more enjoyable experience. So if you give me some examples of the type of recipes you and textures you want to achieve, then maybe that gives us a little bit of focus on how we can come up with some interesting, maybe not now, later.
No, yeah. Fab. Yeah. I'm very happy to point you in the right direction.
We can come up with some ideas and then come up with some varied techniques. Even if it involves always pureeing, you can still get different flavour profiles out of food.
But also, what about the appearance, Michael? Because I know you look at your pictures, and you want to eat them.
Wherever it was, yeah.
Whereas if it was, what was the chef you talked about?
But I think obviously, there's a lot of textures there, and so that's something you can't play too much with. But again, flavour profile is slightly different than texture profile. I mean, you can make things look good even if it's in a bowl or there's different things you can do. But I think that's where the practicality is, not how it's just presented, because it can be presented by a really nice person that understands what your challenges are and presented in a way that makes it easy for you to then eat it. And then when you taste it, it then has all those amazing flavours going on. So I think we have to give some consideration to guest experience and how he or she is then welcomed into the establishment, right, and then made to feel no different. Right. And that's also about pre-planning and pre-understanding of the condition that we're dealing with. And then it's all about those other delicious things that we've been talking about. But I think presentation, obviously, can be looked at, but it's just how you as a patient then need to, you know, how are you actually consuming it is a factor that we have to understand.
Right.
So yes, we had
another question.
Hello, Michael. Can you tell me, will this restaurant card just be for actual restaurants? We've got a cafe. Would we be able to apply that to our cafe?
Yeah, Michael will answer it as well, but it's anybody that is cooking a food, whether it's a Costa Coffee, bless them, or whether it's Michael's restaurant, and there's the full spectrum. Whatever it is in there that you want to go into, we hope that they will be aware and understand the issues that the person in there has, no different than they have to understand all the other issues. This is just another one that, you know. Yeah. So, and we will rely on people like you going into your local cafe and saying, why haven't you got this? Because if there's a cafe down the road, as a businessman, surely you're going to want to know more. Sorry, Michael.
Luckily, we make our food, so you know we're good like that. You know, we make the soups ourselves, so I'm sure we can appertain our menu to it and help. I'd love to be involved. You know.
Yeah, we shared a client who came to us quite regularly, and it's all about facilitating. I mean, we do it all the time in a hotel because you've got guests of different needs and different experiences, and I'm involved with a charity called Blue Badge, and that's all about making spaces for disabled people every bit as beautiful as spaces for, you know, able people, to enable people to enjoy their spaces. And food's the same, you know, it's about enabling people to have the full fulfillment, enjoyment of food, and I think that's as open to anyone within the sector. So the more that come on board, then obviously the better it is for you guys.
Any other questions? Oh, one at the back. Who's got the mic?
Thank you.
David, you're obviously getting tired because you're not running today.
Thank you. I'm another speech therapist. And I just wondered, I love it. It sounds brilliant. And it would be great if eventually there could be like a directory, I presume. And I'm just wondering, this sounds like it's a massive project, because I'm just wondering about training. Because I think what we've heard from people that we work with that have dysphagia, swallowing problems, is even if they go in with a card, because we used to have a trust card that used to say this, and they say to the restaurant, oh, I need this food in whatever texture, or I need that other bit of gravy or something else. Actually, they've been stumped because either the place hasn't had the facilities to do that, or they don't understand and they don't actually know what the texture is. So alongside this launch, would there be some sort of training that would be alongside it for people in the scheme?
So can I come back on that, Michael? So the idea is there'll be a window sticker in the restaurant or the facility. If that's got a sticker in it, they've had something and they've had training, or they've got something in the back to say this is what it is. So, and I've been over the last 7 years dealing with speech and language therapists, coming up with what is needed. And we've now got a training program for the venue. We've got marketing material for the venue. So everything is there. So, I mean, we were going to have a card. This is how long ago I started it. Now we're on apps.
Yeah.
So there's going to be, you'll show them the app and it'll all be there.
I mean, if you tie that idea into your book, into the recipe idea, it's easy. Maybe you can give 4 or 5 examples of recipes made from different textual kind of ideas. So, and that could be condition focused. I mean, yes, if it's a soup, everybody can make a soup and taste it, blend it, taste to make it taste nice. But how do you know, that's not necessarily substantial. So how if we've got to think about, when we talked about nutrition, we need to think about what you need in your meal to feel that you're full up. You know, it's not just about blending food. And if we are, then what is the makeup of that? So I think if you take that idea, if it's an app, it's easy to put a couple of examples. And so that the participant restaurant, cafe or hotel can use those examples as inspiration. So maybe that's a nice thought. And that's an easy thing to do on an app or easier thing to do on an app or on a website, and then just direct everybody there. And it's a good educational tool for those people that want to be a part of it. So,
yeah. And to be fair also, we've got Laura sat there that produced her own cookery book because she was told that she couldn't do anything. And we've produced it, and we've sold over 3,500. And it has got all that information in there. So we've got everything there.
Is that a keepsake?
Yeah.
That's on the menu tomorrow, you know, that's good.
What we never had for 7 years, someone like Michael.
Thank you.
That's the important part. That's the missing part of the jigsaw. I want to take one more question, but I want it from a patient, because I know the speech and languages and all the health officials were loving this session. But I want one from a patient that is there, that has got the problems with eating and drink. Any patient that wants to ask a question. Got to be a patient out there, or a comment. Yes, there you go.
We got one.
Thank you. I'm Lisa. Now, I have problems with, I'm allergic to a lot of things as well, so I can't eat any citrus. So when you look at recipes, and I watch them on the table, and I thought, oh, lemon in that, can't eat that. What could I put in instead? The same like with lime and things like that. What could I put in instead?
Well, vinegar, and you can swap it out. And I know it's not lemon, but it's acidity. Right. So there's lots of different vinegars. So you've got to ask yourself, are you allergic to, is it the lime and the citrus itself, orange, lemon? But then you've got apple vinegar, cider vinegar, you've got xeres or sherry vinegar, white wine. And they give the acidity, and you can use them. And so when you see someone say, oh, you know, add a little bit of lemon juice, just say, well, add a white wine vinegar can be as well. And you can actually get some really refined vinegars.
Right.
You can get raspy vinegar, you know. I mean, so there are other things, and they take on the flavour. Obviously, you don't want to use lemon vinegar, but because, you know, you don't need to. But, yeah, I just swap it out with vinegar.
Right, because I find if I like make us a spaghetti bolognese or a lasagna, I can't have the tomato, I find it too acidic, so I put cream in.
Yeah, that's it. Remember I said about in my speech, I said the balance between sweet, sour, cream. Cream's also good because it's fat, but it carries a huge amount of flavour, fat, but also it gives you mouthfeel, so it gives you smoothness, so we call it that viscosity on the palate, which is good. So that's a good swap out. And again, you know, wine has its own natural bit acidity. So, for instance, if with spaghetti bolognese, if you're making bolognese, often some people say we'll put a bit of red wine in, and that's got natural acidity. So use some red wine vinegar as well, and that gives a bit more acidity, and that cuts through. But yeah, those little techniques like that are good swap outs.
Okay, so if I came to your restaurant with one of these cards.
No, I'm really on the spot, yeah. I knew this was coming.
So what would happen like with me, because obviously I can't eat these things.
Yeah.
So if I looked at one of your recipes and I was like, oh, I really fancy that, but I can't eat it because you've got lemon or lime in it,
yeah.
What would happen?
Okay, well, you'll be pleased to know bolognese is not on the menu. there's that one sorted. No, I mean, what we do with dietaries is we want to know what your problems are before you come so we can deal with them. Yeah. So it's an easy swap if we don't use... I mean, to be honest with you, most people put citrus either at the beginning or at the end. So you would just it's a very nice swap out to say we've made a white wine sauce that would finish with a little lemon juice. You just don't finish it with lemon juice. We have dietaries all the time, and I can tell you, there are some real challenges with food these days, but we try and facilitate as best we can. So I think citrus is a relatively easy one for us.
Right. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
And actually for you in cooking, you can believe me, you can live without lemon and lime, you know, and come up with the same swap out with using vinegar.
Right, okay, lovely, cool. Thank you.
Pleasure.
I know I had Sharon cook me a bolognese and I ended up getting stopped by the police driving and I said to honestly, I've only had a bolognese. She must have two bottles of red wine in her bolognese. Tastes great, but yeah. You don't drink and drive after her bolognese. So thank you very much, Michael, from my heart. Adam, do you want to finish off?
Well, I just wanted to add, I said terrific as well. I'd just like to say, actually, Michael's... team at Limston Manor. I had a dear patient, and as we just briefly mentioned, again, the team went out of their way. He had really significant, you know, issues post treatment and disease, and they fulfilled his wishes to the, you know, supreme.
And it was your credit card.
And he used my credit card.
Thank you.
Yes. Perfect. Michael, you're a star.
Right. Next, I believe, Peter, it's got my cheat sheet here, because it's not showing up there. It is. Laryngectomy. John Organ, Peter Cousins, and Richard Andrews. John and Richard, I don't know. Peter, I do, and for many, many years now.
Yeah, you do, yeah. My mic's not working.
Your mic's not working. Do you want to... Is it... Do you want to come on?
You're on. No problem.
Come on up.
You're on. Lovely to be here.
Nice to meet you. Afternoon. So.
And what are we going to do?
A cappella.
That'll do me, yeah. That'll do. Travel out.
Yes, travel. What have you got? What have you got planned?
Well, I've got a PowerPoint, just very quickly.
Yeah.
My journey. I found that I'm a year, so I was a year today. I was on a 2-week rule. So I looked for help when I was diagnosed and it was done now.
Yeah.
So I did it myself. So I've got a PowerPoint I'd like to share of
and you're
my still, hospital.
You're a year down the line now?
Year down the line.
Smashing. So it's all
is that okay.
Very fresh. Please, John, you're cracking.
No worries, because I've got this little machine here I have to press on. Right, thank you. So, yeah, so I don't want to take over the stage, but it looks like I have. But that's me, I'm afraid. So it's just a quick story about where we were. There are a couple of pictures in there, a little bit graphic, but that's the nature of the beast of a laryngectomy. So I'm sorry you're seeing it after lunch. Oh, I can't read that, is that there? So, yeah, on November the 16th, after about a year of a hoarse voice, there was initially put down a steroid inhaler's side effects. I was diagnosed under a 2-week rule, stage 3 vocal cancer. I had a PET scan of pancreatic cancer. I'd actually induced with my pancreas, which was fine, thankfully, but they found emphysema. So for a year, I had steroid inhalers. And they gave me a hoarse voice, radiotherapy and chemotherapy were the weapons of choice before a final scan to determine full location just before Christmas 2023. And after the final scan, laryngeal cancer stage 4 was what was decided. It was very aggressive. Surgery was planned for January this year. And initially I refused surgery. And they told me I had till June if I didn't have it. So what do I do? So Christmas last year wasn't good. On January the 9th, I went in for 11 hours of surgery. They removed the voice box, 92% of the thyroid, and 84 lymph nodes. After coming round from the surgery, I was told I had COVID, which was wonderful. Very worrying time now, especially when the surgeon came up to me and said, "Don't worry, the antivirals don't work. Within 24 hours, we'll breathe for you." That was a wonderful time. So everything was out of my control. Breathing, eating, choking. I finally went home 14 days later, as I said I would, another 21 days that they said I would. Start my crazy life. That new way of breathing, eating and speaking and swallowing. The future was going to be hard. Very, very hard. And it's just a little bit of our story. So it is looking back at the times gone by before cancer. We was always down about, generally crazy. Too much alcohol on my part. John was always dancing on the table somewhere and usually drunk. Years of working in the building industry. Now, never happened to me. Like Michael was saying, all of a sudden, your life changes overnight. This was the following morning after surgery. I woke up and I was going to take a picture of me for my future blog. To be honest, I looked a lot worse than I felt. There was pain, but not too much. You go with the flow. I slept mainly. Unknown to at this point, I still didn't know I had COVID. They did. I didn't. And this is how I could keep an eye on my readings. I was a total pain, I guess, but medicine and hospitals are my passion. And my mum was a nurse all her life. And they just, some people like cars and films. For me, it's medical. I don't know what it is. Prior to the procedure, I read every paper and document I could find on laryngectomies. I impressed my surgeon so much. We discussed the procedures. It was amazing. I read a whole paper on it once. Said it's the second day following surgery. I asked to be up and out of bed, if only for 30 minutes. I had that 14 days in my head I had to get out. I had a bed with a surgeon. I had every machine going, being tubes and drains in my neck, feeding tubes, lines and medicines, all sorts. Woe is me, this is what this is all about. Woe is me. The blanket you see there on my lap was made for me and my 11 grandchildren, all over them, and my dog. It's the greatest thing to have with me. So that was just got left on the operation from here to here. And they go, yeah, and procedure to give it a trade girls to me. Never gave me any problems, it's totally healed. And today you hardly notice it, which I've got a right hump about. Because all the stories I used to tell the grandchildren, and now they can't even see it. The dreaded feeding tube and the runny nose. You guys will know this one as well. You cannot sniff, you cannot blow. That's been taken away from you. You won't be able to smell or anything. So you roll up tissues and blow them up your nose. Stop your nose from streaming. Something this oxygen machine can help. It takes a while to get used to it. Today I still get runny nose, but I manage it better. Trouble is I've got such a big ooter. They tell me it will block over time. But I don't think there's much chance on my one blocking. And there's a view of the team, surgeon being in the middle, Aaron Takar, speech and language therapy, nurses. I just put this photo in here to tell the story of the team that goes behind you. You're just the one that's laying on the table, but I've made great friends of every one of them, especially my surgeon now. And every time I see him, just every 6 weeks, he's the one that says to me, "Come and jump photo for the vlog." So that's just afterwards, so it's a swallow test. You can see the feeding tube inside, which I didn't like at all. It's a great day when the swallow test is passed, and you can move on to your puree food like you were talking about a minute ago. And you just gloss them off, little victories off, the, you know, to tick them off. But that... So when they do the operation, and they cut everything. You have to have that swallow test to make sure the liquid actually goes into the stomach and not into the lung. And an awful lot of us laryngectomies fail it. And then it's just forever waiting for healing. I was lucky. I passed. Now I put this in here. This is Bodhi, one of my 11 grandchildren. I was so worried when I was in hospital. It was my biggest fear. Is my children, grandchildren would be scared of me. But these you can show here. See here, the Bodhi. He found a bottle top the day one and put it to his neck and spoke to me with a gruff voice. And he even turned his teddy bear into one. We move on. Radiotherapy. 6 weeks, I'll never want again. The single most hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And I had to travel 3 hours, sometimes 4 hours round trip for it. And it was made difficult because of the stoma. It shrunk. Or a Larry tube that made me cough. Some of us go on with our hikers couldn't. And life was hard enough. And that just put me really back. Radiotherapy is what it is. It's doable. Really ain't no fun, is it? So as you can see, around 4 weeks in, I had 6 weeks continuous and it hurt a lot. The last 2 weeks of having it and the first 2 weeks after week eight, they put me to bed. And I'm a strong builder. But I slept in the ambulance, I slept in a waiting room, slept on the table. I eternally burn my beard and I need all the air I can get. But it's growing back. Chemotherapy, I had 2 doses. That's all I had and that was enough. And I had no side effects, other than the attack the nerve endings in my leg, mainly my left side. And that's why I use a stick today. And it's a bit more of a confidence thing. I've had 3 falls, so. Losing my thyroid as I have now, the rest of it, has also affected my joints. And that's long term. I used to be a runner of sorts. Long walks were not a problem and I love to cycle. We'll do it again one day. So this is an image of a TEP valve that I had placed inside my throat while I'm talking. Transesophageal punch. And then a voice prosthesis. And there's a picture coming up shortly that shows inside my stoma with the voice prosthesis in place. And by me pressing the button here, I'm blocking air off. That allows the air to divert, as you can see in the smaller picture. And for me to voice, once again, I'm fortunate. All of us laryngectomy patients can voice. So I'm lucky. If you can't voice, some people get on the electrolarynx, which I also use, because the button doesn't work all the time. So I hold that against, and you make a vibration. But once again, not all laryngectomy patients can. It can be very, a very lonely place. There'll be an laryngectomy sometimes. Because your voice is your personality, isn't it? Everything about you. Just quickly, the HMEs and moisture exchange and base plates. These buttons here do more than just stop air. So there's speech and language therapy team will guide you to everything you need. I always say that the surgeons will take your cancer. And the speech and language therapy teams will give you your life back. And I really believe that. Because without them, I don't have a voice or anything. But yeah, the HMEs, they act as air. They cause like a nasal hairs and they put moisture back into your lungs. So they're not just a fashion statement. If you'd want one. And these are the TEP speaking valves that we push the air through. They're not there for life. They leak. They leak often. Sometimes just on the stage valve changing my own. They can last 3 months. It can last 3 weeks. You'll have a drink or something and it'll just leak. You can clean them and sometimes you just got to go back to hospital and have them changed. It's just the way it is. So you can see there. It's got, I don't know if it's the wrong one, but you can see me nebulizing through my neck. I'll put that on there because that's where we breathe. And we carry badges and things. There's no point putting oxygen over my mouth and nose. It wouldn't go nowhere. And you can see by the picture in the middle, inside my base plate, is my valve. Now, without me pressing the button in on the HME, I wouldn't be able to divert the air. It's tiring as a laryngectomy to talk sometimes, because you're pushing air, not just using it to breathe, but pushing it through the hole to open up a flapper to voice. So it worries me again. Anyway, we're nearly the end. So this was us, my children, about 2 months after radiotherapy, where we went to the Royal Marsden Cancer Hospital and we raised a crazy £1,600. There's a photo of the family that all walked with me on date hours. I become an ambassador for the Throat Cancer Foundation, Swallow's Head and Ear Cancer, the Oracle Cancer Trust, and sit on 2 patient boards. I now see my illness as a new calling, and my aim is to raise awareness so that others that follow me do not do so in the dark. So here we are today, standing in front of you. We have a health group on Instagram. There's over 450 members talking about throat cancers, and mainly all cancers. I made good friends with a lady with a brain tumour, for instance. We run Facebook groups as well as Twitter accounts, and all to raise awareness and early detection, laryngectomy community meetings and the next step. And from where I was in the darkness, if we could help just one person come into the light, then job would be done, wouldn't it? Thank you.
Richard, I think, is next on.
Follow that. But let's try. Do you want to put my slides? What do I do? A little background first. Prior to this, I'm still married. 3 kids, live in Hereford. I actually sold Michael Caine's an ice cream machine many years ago. They said earlier, if you're fat and you don't do any exercise, you won't get cancer. That's rubbish. I was 18 stone. Exercise, getting in and out of a car. And that was all I did. I was first diagnosed in 2018. And my wonderful surgeon said, 30 radiotherapy sessions, you'll be fine. Shouldn't be an issue. Stage 2. After 30 radiotherapy sessions, and I began thinking of things to do to try and occupy myself, because as John said, it can be a little bit of a dark place at times. So I joined a local health club with my daughter who's sitting over there, and just came up with ideas to get fit, because radiotherapy, you end up losing a little bit of weight. So I lost about 3 stone with the radiotherapy. So I set myself some challenges. So I did a duathlon. I did a 10K run. Just to get myself going, joined a triathlon club. And we did an event called Run Fest with my daughter, which was organised by Chris Evans. Unfortunately, at the end of the run, I collapsed into the arms of a very big Marine, who then took me to the medical area. Went back to my doctor. It had reoccurred, and that was about 4 months after I'd been given the all clear. So, next stage, go to the hospital with my lovely wife, who's actually an intensive care nurse. Only to be told, cancer'd come back again on my right vocal cord. Total laryngectomy needed. Hence, here I am now. 2nd of July, I had the operation. Was due to leave hospital after 2 weeks. But unfortunately, I failed my swallow test. So I was in there for another couple of weeks. While I was in there, I started planning a few more goals and a few more ideas. And I actually entered the Cardiff Half Marathon while I was in hospital. So, got out of hospital in the August, and then in the October I did the Cardiff Half Marathon. And then it just snowballed from there. I just had more ideas about what to do. So I then did a 50k ultramarathon in the following February. And then a half marathon at the Alton Park. But then COVID struck, so all events were cancelled, so I was a little bit bollocksed. Sorry, I'm swearing. So, while COVID happened, I carried on training, but I hadn't started planning to do other things as well. The duathlon, which is cycling and running, and then I did 100k ultra. But it just kept on. Once I'd done that, I wanted to do something else. I went back into hospital because what can happen is your esophagus tends to help me get smaller, constrict. So you have to go back in to have it stretched. So I went back in to have it stretched, and it's an easy operation. You're in there overnight. Unfortunately, they managed to perforate my esophagus while we were doing it. So I ended up in hospital for an extra week. It was while I was in hospital then that I heard from one of my nurses about a special snorkel that they make that can help you swim. So I thought, well, take it a stage further, I might start swimming as well. So this is a new type of, it's a snorkel that was being developed. So that's a tracheostomy tube. So what you basically do is put the tracheostomy tube in the hole in your neck, inflate it, and then attach a snorkel to it. And jump in a pool. A few rules. You don't jump in. For obvious reasons. Because, as John said, we only breathe through this particular hole. But there's a few rules. So you can only swim for... You can't swim for any longer than an hour. And you can only swim in a pool. So I did a lot of pool triathlons. So basically you swim 200 metres. Then you cycle. Then you run. So I did those up until July. But what I hadn't told my wife was I had an idea of doing a half Ironman, which is basically swimming a mile and a half, cycling 50 miles, and then running a half marathon. Great idea, but it's in a lake in the middle of September. And it was a little bit chilly. Unfortunately, I was swimming with two other people who basically kept me afloat, because every now and again you have to disconnect the snorkel while you're in the water and then cough out. so they were keeping me afloat while I was coughing out. The trouble was, the water was 14 degrees. And I ended up being in the water for about an hour and a half. So, I was a little bit cold. I didn't know I was cold, but I was cold. The only thing I remember about the swim is when I got out of the swim, I had to be helped out by two paramedics. And all I could hear was my wife sobbing in the background as I was getting out of the water. So I then ran to the bike, got on the bike, and out of a 50-mile cycle, I managed to do 30 miles before they stopped me to tell me that I had hypothermia and had to stop. So unfortunately, my core temperature had dropped a little bit, so I was a little bit groggy, should we say. So these are just a few pictures. Out of all the events I did one event, which was a World Triathlon Championship. And it's basically the introductory one, and I actually came first in my age group. So that's the one thing that's... But my daughter over there has been the one that's been with me most of the way in training and doing various, helping me prepare. The other thing you're not supposed to do with a snorkel on is go in the sea. And I blame my daughter for that. So the picture on the bottom left is me in a lake. Again, a little bit dodgy. The one in the middle, and that's there in the bottom, is me coming out of the water at Eva Castle after 1.2 miles. So that was interesting. So since my operation, and since being diagnosed, I've done 6 triathlons, and a few other bits and pieces as well. But what I want to say is the one thing that hadn't been covered at the conference really was about exercise and how important it is for cancer patients to actually get out and exercise, because it's a thing that's helped me the most. So whether that's, if you like running, cycling, fine, but just walking and just getting out and exercising helps the mind, but it also helped my recovery, but gave my wife a few sleepless nights. Plans, it's my 5th year, so I've only planned a few little bits and pieces. But I think the key thing, as John said, is having a focus, because it's very, very difficult, and it is very lonely, and you get very anxious. I mean, I've never spoken in front of people since I've had this. I didn't know I was struggling going to work. And now, from being a sales manager, I stack shelves at Sainsbury's, which is great because I get to chat to people, scare them, and it's good fun. But the exercise just keeps your mind going and gives you something to focus on. To round off a few thank yous, my wife and daughter are sitting over there. And I'm very lucky. There's 4 people sitting at the back, and John said about the nurses, the doctors. They're the people that actually see you every time. I mean, I'm a really easy patient. I don't give them any trouble at all. See, but a big thank you to those guys and the SLTs and everybody else. The doctors are surgeons. I've had 2 surgeons. I had Mr. Warner that did the initial operation, but he can't stitch in a straight line, so he got somebody else to do the stitching. But then another doctor took over, Mr. Daltrey, the nurse's favourite. And they're brilliant. I can't say enough about the surgeons and the healthcare staff. My wife's an intensive care nurse, so I've been very, very lucky. Claire's not here, she's based at the Royal Exeter Hospital. She's the lady that fitted me with a snorkel. And without a doubt, I mean, the swimming has been great. And one of the things we need is more money to actually start making them again, because they don't make them anymore. I was the last person to be fitted with one. So, we need to look at that for people that, with laryngectomies, getting them in the water, getting them active. That's me. Thank you very much.
And after the two stories you just heard, mine, unfortunately, is going to be very, very boring. I haven't done marathons. I sit on my backside a lot of the time. But my story is it all started back in 2011. I've always suffered all my life with a sore throat. If I was going to get a cold or flu, the first thing would be my throat. And back in 2011, I got a sore throat. And this went on for 6 to 8 weeks. And my wife kept nagging me to go to the doctor. And eventually, I plucked up the courage and off I go to see my family doctor. The next doctor I see was Mr. Rees. No problem, they had a look and they said, we'd give you a partial laryngectomy, but first you have to come in for a biopsy. So when I go for the biopsy, when I come round, great news, you haven't got cancer anymore. We've lasered it away. Could have a course of radiotherapy, which was lovely because it was over the Christmas and New Year period. And I started off, and I've done a week, New Year's morning, I had my breakfast, I ate a bit of toast, and I nearly went through the ceiling, because it suddenly hurt. Going on with me radiotherapy a couple of days later, I happened to mention to the speech therapist and the dietitian that I hadn't eaten for a couple of days. Believe it or believe it not, I couldn't walk out of the hospital, because they give me so many of these nutrition drinks, I couldn't carry them. Eventually, with their assistance, I got home. That was fine. That went on for about a year. In the meantime, I was going up to see Mr. Reeves and the team. And unfortunately, in the July 2013, he came back. There was nothing less than to have a full laryngectomy. But it was difficult because I previously had radiotherapy. So there was doubts as to whether it was going to work. So I was admitted to Exeter Hospital. On the Tuesday, I had the operation on the Wednesday. Because that time my wife was suffering with breast cancer, they pulled me back to Torbay on the Sunday. Prior to this, in one of the interviews, my wife was worried that I'd have a Dalek-type voice. And the nurse, Julie at the time, said, you no need to worry. He will still have that London accent. Fine. So I go back to Torbay Hospital on the Sunday. On the Monday, Julie came in and said, come with me, you. Took me off to a little room, put the valve in. It was the wrong size valve. So I had to lay on the back with her finger down my throat for about 15 minutes. And she wasn't gentle, being a nurse. Eventually, they got the right size. Put it in, and she said, well, say something. And I did. My London voice returned. That was on the Monday. On the Thursday, I was home. And everything's been fine since, and this was 10 years ago. But I did have problems in the early days getting the right valve. I was back up the hospital seeing Mr. Rees and the team every 2 weeks having a new valve fitted. Eventually they found a valve that works. It was, believe it or not, the cheaper version. But because I've got quite strong breath, I may be, you've got to have a strong breath to make it work. And now that valve lasts up to a year before I have to have it replaced. Well, that's it, you know, I use all the types of different HMEs for, there's different ones. There's one for relaxing, there's one for sleeping. But I normally use the micro one, which I've got on the tight now. And since having the laryngectomy, I've never had colds or flu, and I've never even had COVID. So that's quite amazing, I think. Probably down to the HME I use. But that's it, really. There are drawbacks. Some of the drawbacks are talking a group of more or two people. They don't hear, people don't hear you. But, you know, sometimes when you talk in a group, more than two, three, four, they're all talking, and then you, because you're talking, you've got to press a button. You're slower to start. So somebody else says something before you do. And I have been known to bang the table, like a master of ceremonies, which stops everybody. And talking in a noisy environment. We were talking earlier on, and it was very hard to hear me. I don't know what it is. My voice seems quite loud, but other people appear to find it difficult to talk, to hear me in a noisy environment. I'm also unable to control the volume or the tone of my voice as easy as I did prior to having it. So some people think I'm aggressive. And I do come across aggressive. And also I've noticed I abbreviate things and I make, instead of having a nice sentence, I cut it down to as many words, as least words as possible. There are times when we're out shopping in a supermarket and Chris is my wife's name, I say, "Well, Chris, look at this." And people look and sometimes they give you a double look. My answer is, "Don't worry, I'm an apprentice Darth Vader." Which they look in amazement and that's the end of that. The other thing I find a bit awkward, some clinicians, doctors and nurses not involved in the ear, nose and throat department are a bit weary. They sort of, "What do I do now?" You can sense it. And I try and put them at ease. Like I had an operation and the surgeon said, "Oh, what about your breathing?" Yeah. I just said, "It's not your problem, it's the niece's problem." You know, so. Now there are exceptions to those clinicians, and that's the entire in it. Ear, nose and throat team at Torbay. From Mr. Reese to the nurses, the speech therapists and the dietitian. They take a lot of beating. All right, I might be creeping here a bit, but they're a good crowd, as previous speakers have said about their surgeons. But my life hasn't changed, really. I can do everything I did before. The exception be swimming, because you've got to have equipment like that. But it might be a bit slower, but I've got no problems whatsoever. And I often go and try and, people that can have the operation, I try and talk to them. But it's not as bad as what it sounds. We do frighten people, and previous speakers said it does happen, particularly youngsters. You've got to be careful with youngsters because they're amazement. And I'm a dog lover, and I've been attacked by two dogs since I've done this. Not attacked, but had a go at, they bark, you know. They're all right, you can pat them until you open your mouth and you say something. So it must be to do with the tone of the voice. But that's my story. It's not as good as the others, but that's it really. There's nothing more I can say. But life's as good now as it was before. In some respects, it's better. The only problem I have, as I say, is when we go out eating in restaurants, the noise, I just sit there and eat. You can't talk, because it's the environment. Anyway, there's my story. Thanks for listening to me.
Thank you. Actually, Peter briefly alluded to something which I'd like to thank him for is, well, one thing is like teaching me a lesson of wasting thousands of pounds worth on the wrong valve. And we should have used the cheap one. and the other one, as he mentioned, is that whenever someone's up for a laryngectomy, the team, we try and get them to meet someone who's already had a laryngectomy. And you try and match them, you know, as best you can, you know, character-wise, you know, gender-wise, age-wise. And Peter's been a terrific mentor for all the guys who've had, you know, for a great many who've had laryngectomies since. He's a terrific guy. And yeah. Are you guys up for a few questions?
Yeah, I'll just come in and say one thing. Yeah. As a head and neck patient, the last thing I wanted was my voice taken away from me. So when I see people like yourself, I'm in awe of your treatment and how you deal with it. And all three, you know, are inspirational stories. And I think if anyone's ever going to have a laryngectomy and listen to any of you three, they're going to know that there's a life after. And I think each one of you deserve a massive, massive round of applause for sharing them stories with us, but also being inspirational in each individual one. Fab. The swallows in the past has never really had the opportunity to get involved in the laryngectomy world. It's something that we've always tried, something we've never done, maybe because we're head and neck patients. I do find when we have online meetings, going back to your point about talking, when we have an online meeting, which we do every month, internationally we have more laryngectomy patients on there than we have head and neck. And I think there's more of a protocol on Zoom meetings where people do put their hand up. They don't have to bang on the table like you have to. They put their hand up and they talk. So I think laryngectomy patients globally interact more online than they do possibly with us. So going forward in 2024 now, we've obviously building these relationships. I definitely want to take the swallows into this land, because if I'm going to have a head and neck operation and I listen to you and they tell me I've not got to take my voice off, whatever you give me is a bonus, because I'm not losing my voice. So you'll even be able to inspire people with head and neck. And I think you, all three of you, are fantastic. And bit of news that I'm going to do, and we talked about the Maldives. Yeah, you remember the Maldives, and the amount of emails I'm getting to go on that restaurant is unbelievable. But I've been speaking to that Maldives people and the CEO, and I told them about Richard's story, and I mentioned it briefly to you, haven't I? So what they're looking at doing is they're going to contact Richard, and they are going to pay for him and his family to go to the Maldives, and they want him to be at the bottom of the sea, looking up at the fish, because they said that if they can do that, everyone else's disability just is forget about it. So we are looking at taking yourself and the family out to the Maldives. Unfortunately, I can't go. Sharon has volunteered. I don't know why Sharon has volunteered to hold your bags and take them. And if anyone else wants to volunteer to help them, then obviously that's... But they are looking, seriously, in 2024 to get you out to the Maldives, put you in some sort of system where you will be at the bottom of the sea being filmed, looking at the wonderful fish that are in the sea of the Maldives. And if we can do that, then get you there. Anybody that's going to have a laryngectomy has got to look at that and say, we can get there. So that's going to happen in 2024. We hope next year at the conference, you're going to come back with the films and the experience and talk about the Maldives. A, you'll be able to use the restaurant card. B, you'll be able to swim. B, C, if you look at it, I'll send you the link. Look at the area. It's phenomenal. I'll be jealous as hell, but you'll be there in 2024. So I just wanted to say that.
I'll promote his snorkels. They're more snorkels made then.
we need to get people to build them as well, because they were built by a German company then, because of Brexit and COVID, they stopped making them.
So but again, the last. You've proved anything is possible.
Yeah, right.
So just because we have boogie boards, and a lot of people, you use one of the, let's say, old-fashioned boogie board. I deal with a company in America that now have an iPad as a boogie board, and they're sending me over 100 of these boogie boards because the UK won't sell them. There's always a way to do things if we've got all these people. And with your inspirational story, if we need to find a company to do it and they get some publicity around Maldives and everything else, then, hey, we have to use what we get. But that will happen. When I know the details, I will make sure that we get those available, even if it's on our website for people to buy. But we've got to make it happen. Fundraising is the ultimate one. But stories will happen and we'll get it there. So I'm a great believer in that anything is possible when I see your three stories. So that's irrelevant about who's going to make it, but it will happen. So that's my little bit on that. So go for questions.
Pay for the insurance. You've got to pay for the insurance to get out of there. That's incredible, isn't it, Larry?
Yeah.
That'd be 10 times more.
Jesus, I don't want much, did I? Would you like me to get the taxi as well? And
that'd be nice, wouldn't
and,
it? Wife's got a credit card, I'm fine. Well, he's just doing half a job.
Oh, my God. Someone always wants one more, don't they?
All right.
Hey? Yeah, right. Questions. There must be some questions. Or comments.
That's disappointing, isn't it? Go on.
Oh, here we go.
They've lost their voices.
One.
It's for all three of you, really. What sort of advice would you give to somebody who has maybe just had a laryngectomy, who currently doesn't have the ability to verbalise, or maybe has recently started verbalising and maybe not be happy with their voice? Have you got any tips, suggestions, or kind of processing thoughts on those patients?
Yeah, I'll just go quickly first. Only speaking of, you can only speak of your own experience. So I was lucky enough to be able to voice straight away. Very quietly. Speech and language therapy teams, there's 1,000 different voices, valves, HMEs, bass plates, if you can't voice. For me personally, they will change something. There's a way around it. That's what I've been told. I've always been able to voice. I know some haven't been able to voice, and to do with the operations and et cetera. But it's not so much for me about voicing. It's communication. For the 10 days or so after surgery, when you are a mute, and you are using about the best you can or writing down. Doctors are just as much to blame for anyone else. They don't listen to you. They look over your head and they want to move on to the next patient. No one has time for you. As long as you can communicate, yeah, just give us time, really. But there are a load of different ways. It's not just one size fits all.
It just takes time as well to get used to it. I mean, my voice sounds totally different. I mean, I had a Glaswegian accent before, so it's completely changed. But now it's just, you just get used to it in the end. But also, my speech and language therapist who left. No, before then. The young lady girl were... No, before then. Basically, Eva, she told me that just after the operation, you can't actually speak without having one of these. But the only words you can say are swear words. So that's how I used to communicate with my consultant. A lot of the time.
Best way and all, best way.
But now when the SLTs work with you, and there's lots of different ways of communicating to start with, and it's just being patient.
Yeah, it might be the valve, maybe the valve, like in my case.
It's chopping well and changing. It's working it out. It's great first off. Sometimes it's great, and then it deteriorates. If you've had radiotherapy, that. Like as things up for a while, and
yeah, well, I had that, didn't I?
Yeah, and the scar tissue, but
tell me about it.
Yeah, there's different valves. It's the getting over it all. It's the coordination, because it's all disconnected and reconnected, and it can take time. It can just take time.
It's a frame of mind, because I know when I had my operation, when I went in there, I was determined I would talk again. So I would not use paper or pen. I used sign language and clicks, as I do with my wife today. No, we're at the table and I'm eating, and she'll say something, and I can't answer, because I'm eating. So I click, or, you know, she knows I do one it. Click for you. Yeah.
And I do it, I get told off all the time for doing that. See? Yeah, they do. My wife says I'm a dolphin.
Yeah.
What you do is, you got your hands in a bowl of water, and she knows they're nothing for an hour. And you put your hands in a bowl of water, and she says, we'll walk the dog in a minute.
Fair enough.
I like your idea though, where you say you sound aggressive, you turn the you look aggressive, and then you bang a table. So maybe you are aggressive, but I think that's a great way of doing it.
You've got to get attention. So, as I said, I would not use pen or paper. Or they use computers today. I was determined to get my voice back. So that was my goal. And as I said, I had the operation on the Wednesday. On the Monday, I was speaking. And Julie's actual words were in your office when Christine asked.
Yeah.
She said his words were, he'll have that bloody London accent back. And I got my bloody London accent back.
So, Richard, when you go to the Maldives and you see one of these dolphins, have a chat with them.
I will. No, brilliant.
And, John, you're absolutely right. Time. You know, you've got to...
Time.
As I've said, too many people know here, I'm the world's worst lip reader. And you're putting up with this time without speech for ages. Got to, write it down. I'm atrocious at lip reading. But just try and stay with it. Try not to look frustrated. And sort of pay attention. I'm talking about the carers, because... It's bad, you're in a tough enough position as it is without feeling you're putting us out.
Yeah,
I said to a professor, I was talking about it earlier, I was talking to Bill about it, and I said to him, you have to remember, this is your 9 to 5, but this is my effing life. So you've got to give me some time and respect.
Without doubt.
I think on that note, I think we're going to have to wrap. I would sit here and talk all night, but obviously we are on the last day and we are coming up to the last session. I don't want you all disappearing on the last two speakers, otherwise I will be in trouble, but please stick with them. We would be talking to you all night long. I think it's very inspirational. Our next two also are inspirational people, so again, thank you guys.
Thank you, Vita.
Thank you for everything. Brilliant. Who's next?
Sid,
isn't it? Yeah, the last. We saved the last to battle
to last.
The best, haven't we? And Laura will mention who she is, and have you got your cookbook?
That's the last one.
She's got it. Go online on our site, and you'll find her cookbook, and it's incredible.
You don't need
one. So we're going to leave the stage now.
Yeah, I'm off.
Laura is going to...
You want
to... Oh, you need a headphone. You need to go over there.
And strip off.
So shall we entertain?
Come on, Zep.
Do you want to come and dance with us?
Oh, no.
No. Do you want to tell a joke? Clean.
Oh.
No,
that hasn't happened.
Someone told me a joke yesterday, and we can't go on, Phil. You can look me all you like, but I can't go on without the speakers. Me. No. No. That's taken as. No. It's a our venue for next year is a secret until after this. Well, that'll be where.
Sorry.
Yeah. I'm eating. Those little bugs and eyeballs and Yeah, right. Are we all sorted? So should we leave it to the wonderful...
I think we should.
Over to you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Laura. I'm a principal receptionist person who is 4 years no residence of disease, and now my mouth has been overshadowed it. yes, I did write a recipe book for the swallows in 2020, it was, and it is available for free from the swallows website. And there's a link on Twitter that I'll post out later on. But enough about me. I would like to introduce two wonderful people to talk about their journey. First of all, would be Sid Platt. So, then.
I've got some good news and some bad news. The good news is I can't spit as well as Emma Riley. That's just for the front rows here, okay? The bad news is she's given me this really good stuff which helps to make spit. So be careful. I've used a bit, but I'll stick to the traditional water. Right, I'm old. No, I'm old young. And in the 1950s, my mum said, that mouth of yours will get you into trouble one day. I don't think she had what happened to me in 2018 in mind. I think she was more like, I'm going to give him a clip round the ear. But fast forward to 2017-18, there I am, worried about world peace, worried about climate change, worried about where I left my bloody car keys. And I did a dry October for Macmillan Nurses. February 2018, I'm diagnosed with stage 4 tonsil cancer. How's that? You go and help Macmillan out, and they give you a gift. Absolutely ridiculous. But it was a small lump. But my story, this is all about my story. No, it's not. This is a story about others. And I had to make a list of these. These are the doctors, the surgeons, the ENT nurses, the radiographers, the chemo staff, the speech therapists, the dietitians, the pathologist. Thank God I came to yesterday. I thought pathologist looked at dead bodies only. But there you are. The pathologists, the receptionists, the medical secretaries. Honestly, it's the cast of Ben-Hur to cure Sid. It's amazing. It's amazing. So my role was a minor starring part. And then there's some other people. My postie, who turned up when he'd heard I got the news, because I was a gobby sort of person. I went missing. And he offered to help out. Neighbours who offered to mow the lawn in my absence, although I did try to do it once or twice. My family and my wider family, and even my gym instructor. My gym instructor, because he became really valuable in the process of recovery. You know, I've seen all that stuff. And when it said about after effects, I had 37 of those. 37, there are only 30 on the list. So, you know, I've got some more to add. But all of those, but there was one, the one I haven't mentioned, my leader, a.k.a. my her indoors. Now, I'm just checking. She's not here. She had a bridge match, much more important than listening to her husband. I'm not tagged. No, I'm okay. Right, I can tell you the truth about her. Strong woman, journalist, retired journalist, went to the dark side, became a spin doctor. The moment she sat there, I didn't hear stage 4 because I was in process by then. I didn't have that why me phase. I just thought, bugger it, I'm going to get through this. And she heard it. So she set about a business plan. And this business plan included her. She's Jewish. She goes to a dusted down Jewish cookbook and fattens me up because she heard the bit about losing weight. And she fattened me up, put 2 stone on me nearly. It really was. And then she did spreadsheets so she could check my calories, check my health, etc., etc. And then she did, because she's a journalist, she's got to write something, a family blog. Now, we've got 4 sons spread around the world from 2 marriages. The first one was a rehearsal for both of us. And the 4 sons, one in Australia, he's a barista. And I've been telling everybody for years he's a barrister, but he's a barista. good university education, one who's a professor, a language professor in Italy, one who's a big cheese in the civil service, but we don't talk about him because he works for Suella Braverman, and he lives in Staffordshire. I hope there's nobody down from Staffordshire. And the final one is a big a showcase IT person in Bournemouth. Yeah, I better get that right. And she kept the family blog going. And that's really important because the support unit is more than just that one person left with all the heavy lifting. You know, so she could share with them, because when she was depressed, she told them, and they voiced back support for her, because that was the important thing, not me, because Sid was Sid. He was getting sorted. So I went through the whole process. It's all been displayed here. The tests, the rig fitting. Oh, and the bloke next to me that one night, I really was abusive to the staff. And I really did tell him off. In fact, if I hadn't had the rigging, I'd have bopped him. And the chemo. And I kind of showcased through a lot of that. I didn't feel that it was a bad thing. Who's going to need this rig? 3 weeks later, that juice was going in. Yeah. The Mako boys, it soon started to get dependency culture. But it went well. Got through, rung the bell, did all the business with thanked all the staff. By the way, thanking staff, do you remember in COVID when we all went out on those summer evenings and applauded the staff? Do you remember? Hands up all those in the medical profession here. Just put your hands up. You are not a fashion item for another warm, sunny evening in COVID. You are ours. You're us. We've invested in you and we love you. Okay, so enough of that. And you're not paid enough, by the way. That's the ex-trade union official talking. But then she finds me on the bathroom floor in July, spewing this yellow stuff out. What's all that about? I said, community nurse. And she said, no, 999, because she kind of like bullies me. And anyway, the paramedics, I forgot them on the list. They turn up. 8 days in isolation ward. What was it? Sepsis and pneumonia. I was going to breeze through it, wasn't I? I was going to breeze through it. Sepsis and pneumonia. And do you know the person who saved my life was a speech therapist. She came in, I'm feeling really sorry for myself, kept falling asleep during the World Cup. And there she is. She says, here's a child's yogurt. Sid, it's not food, it's medicine. It took me an hour to get through that children's yogurt. But by heck, that saved my life. So the mind games went on. I got better. I accused her of bullying. But it meant a new thing to me. The 4 a.m. shuffle used to be the let's avoid the prostate issue. 4 a.m. Now the 4 a.m. at this period is, I wonder if I'm going to get through it. I wonder if I'm going to survive. That 4 a.m. doubt. You know, the darkest hours just before dawn, da-di-da-di-da. And then I'm thinking to myself, yeah, I'm going to get through it. So the mind games went on. And in those periods where you're going to clinic, that was interesting because about a week before I was due to go to clinic, I'd be going, oh, bloody hell. Oh, no. And then you get that word. The camera goes up. Nothing special about you. What do you mean nothing special about me? There is everything special about me. No, I'm all clear. That's all I wanted to really hear. So we get to swallows. Or just before swallows. We had a group going. The poor old chap was moving off. And the what I called the Dangerous Sisters, the girls from ENT, came to me and said, would you like to help out with the group, facilitate it? I said, God, my ego's still intact. Let's do it. And it really meant something to me, payback, giving them something back for what they've done for me. And I said, the deal is no administration on you. I kidded them, I was competent. And that was really important because they felt they didn't have to do anything extra administratively because they're knackered. You know, when people talk about the health service and what went wrong, you know, if the health service was Amazon delivery, it would be easy, wouldn't it? You order it, gets to your doorstep. If you don't like it, you kick it out. medical science isn't like that. And some things do go wrong. So the group was going well. Then COVID hit us, obviously. And then we heard about swallows. One of our group mentioned swallows. So we arranged a meeting with Chris. And my wife described it as the egos have landed. And I liked Chris. He's got my style. And I think he might have liked me. We were probably a bit wary at the start. We were dancing around it. But then it emerged. What swallows had was resource. What they had were contacts. What they had was experience. And there's me just sort of going through the motions of keeping people together and trying to be cheerful Charlie, essentially. And so the payback for me is swallows. It's enabled us to maintain what we wanted, mutual support. There are some people who say we should be a political campaigning organisation. Hey, I'd love that. I spent 37 years being a political campaign. You can tell my success. Just have a look at Suella Braverman. But there you are. So swallows is something that means something to me now. And the next development is as a result of being involved in swallows. Because people have come to me and said, is there any concerns that you have? And I said, yes. The concern I have is the disconnect between repairing you, getting you well, looking after you, and then discharge. The disconnect with primary care. And I've discovered, I've done some research, it's basically a set of small businesses. And you can't blame the Conservatives. It was already there, the contract. And so our next move is to speak to all of the GP surgeries in a really simple aim. To get the swallows leaflet in every surgery in Cornwall. And by heck, we're going to do it. We're going to do it. So we're going to get that disconnect reconnected. Final comment, because I'll get into trouble from... She was a nurse, so I know how they bully. Final comment. It's a statement, a philosophical statement from two great intellectual giants of Britain, Keith Richards and Mick Jagger. Live enthusiastically. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I like the energy of a bunny. That's awesome. Thank you, Sid. So now over to Denise Woodsy.
Good afternoon. I'm the last one. You'll be probably glad to know I won't keep you too long, but thank you very much for allowing me to come here and talk about my experience. Yes, I was nursing at one time, and I'm seeing it from a completely different point of view to probably most patients who have head and neck cancer. And it is very different when you're on the other side. It's actually more scary than I ever thought I would be. And that was the incredible thing. I've always stood up there and, you know, being very competent and very brave, because that was the sort of job that you did. And suddenly you become this vulnerable older woman with cancer. So there we go. So anyway, this is my story. It starts off with, unfortunately, I got eventually diagnosed in 2021. But of course, that was COVID. And I had a strange symptom, and it was incredible ear pain in my right ear. And it just wouldn't go, and it was keeping me awake at night. And of course, GPs didn't want to see you, so I called the surgery, and I said, look, you know, something's going on in my ear, and I think it needs to be examined, which means you need to see me. No, we can't see you. So, but we'll prescribe you a course of antibiotics. So I said, well, I don't know, but, you know, you do it, don't you? Because it could be an ear infection. So I took the antibiotics, and unfortunately, they didn't work. I didn't think they'd work, so I rang the surgery again. And I said, look, you've got to see me, because I want someone to examine my ear. It's COVID. Right, okay, it's COVID. So I don't care. I am coming to your door and you're going to examine my ear. Because, you know, I used to advocate for patients, so I'm going to advocate for myself now. So I went to the surgery door and I did see the patient. They let me in, all masked up, you know, as you do. And they examined my ear. couldn't see anything. So I said, right, okay, you better have another course of antibiotics. And if that doesn't work, we'll see you back here again. And I thought, time's now ticking on. And you think, what's going on with my ear? Never in a month of Sundays thought it was cancer. So anyway, I unwillingly took the second course of antibiotics. Of course, it didn't work. And then I said, and I am now knocking on your door, and I'm back, and you're going to refer me. And I said, look, an ear comes under ENT. You're going to refer me to ENT. And I think I must have seen a trainee GP, and she just looked at me, and she said, well, what, I'll get the form. So you've got the form online. And she said, they need... what are your symptoms? And at the time, I just started to get a bit of a metallic taste in my mouth. So I said, well, I've got two symptoms that I think, I don't know if they're connected, but they're odd. And she said, okay, you need three symptoms. I said, okay, I'm going to lie. I have difficulty in swallowing. But that's the honest truth. They wanted three symptoms. Now, other people, this is the message I suppose I want to say, they won't know to lie. They might just say two symptoms and you wouldn't get a referral for this two-week wait. So here I am and I'm thinking, right, I'm going to get this two-week wait. And I did. And I am very lucky I'm here today because I am very lucky to live in this area. Just Torbay was a hospital. I went to the centre there and they were absolutely brilliant. But I'm just going to try and get this to work. Oh, all right, okay, yeah, sorry. I have a racing theme in mind because my background is cars. So on your marks, are really, you know, okay, we've seen, I've got to see a GP, I've got referred, okay. They're simple slides, by the way, couldn't see anything doing anything complicated. So then you get set, waiting to be seen for an urgent appointment. And I must be honest, all my nursing side of me kept thinking, you know, it could be not good news. So I did have a lot more anxiety than I thought I'd ever have, to be quite honest, having never suffered with anxiety or anything like that. And you began to think things, don't you? You know, when you're waiting for that first meeting. Anyway, we had it, and it was about 6 months down the line. And you kind of think, this unpleasant taste, I read up a bit more about it. And I thought, yeah, okay, this may not be good news. Prepare yourself, Denise. And, you know, I did try to. So I got my meeting with the ENT team here. A very, very nice consultant. Not this one who's here today, but there was another one, and he was really nice. he had a look. Was it you?
No, it was a nice one.
It was a nice one, yeah. Yeah, good point. Anyway, hang on, I've got a sip of water. So, so I had this meeting and, you know, he did those nasoendoscopies, put the tube up your nose, as you've all, you know, a lot of you know. I thought, oh my God, this is awful. I could look around in my back of my throat and said, I can see something. I thought, oh God, here we go. My heart dropped. My husband was with me. I thought, right, brace. So I did. And they said, we want you to come in for a biopsy quickly. So I said, okay, fine. So had the biopsy. To cut a long story short, the guys who started this conference, pathologists are marvellous. I know that they're, you know, they're in the background and they are marvellous. And I know I'm here today because of pathology, because, of course, they showed me a stage four. I had a stage four squamous cell cancer in the base of my tongue. And I thought, I don't like squamous cell. Of course, I'm a nurse. I've heard of it. And base of tongue, I'm thinking, geez, how the hell do you get to that? Because a lot of cancers, of course, removed surgically or whatever. So I'm thinking, and then you begin to sort of alarm bells are ringing. Anyway, I got called back and, sorry, I've got to put my glasses on for this bit. One of the great things of getting older is that you can't see. It was the waiting for the results. You've all been through that and it was horrid. Yeah, it was. And I felt so sorry for my husband, and you talked about carers and things, and I couldn't imagine what he was going through. I really couldn't. So where are we? We're off, and then Well, it's a whirlwind. You've seen all the different procedures that everyone goes through, different scans. I'm not going to go through them. But what a whirlwind. I'm thinking, crikey, if I was racing, I'd be, wow, you know, winning here. One of the worst things I never thought I'd ever think it, or see, because I've never come across it in my nursing career, was having this mask made. And it's horrid. I don't care what anyone says, it's horrible. But do you know what? Even worse than that was having a peg fitted. I hated it. I saw it as an alien. It intruded my body and I just hated it. And I did. I really did. I struggled with that peg all through my treatment. Not the fact I needed it. I didn't use it that much, but it was there. And it reminded me and it changed me. And there was things about self-esteem and, you know, how you view yourself and the relationships that you have, like with your husband. And I just didn't want him near me. I didn't want anything. It was horrid, really. I hated that thing and I couldn't wait to get it out. And I kept asking them. They said, well, you can't have it out yet. And I said, well, I'd like it out. when I first had it fitted, the stomach, I forgot that your stomach's going to actually shrink a bit. So there I am. You have to spend a night in overnight. I think Sid said he had a night overnight. I wanted to clunk the man in the next bed to me as well. Because he couldn't let me sit. He probably was. And, you know, and I'm thinking, my God, this is awful. They gave me a meal. And I said, I don't think I can eat all that. Well, try and eat a bit. Well, they wanted me to eat more. They keep pushing food, you know, and I'm thinking, I don't want it. But anyway, I had a bit. And then I had the most awful indigestion because, of course, I'd had a new peg tube fitted. And one of the feedback things I gave to the CEO of Torbay, because I did actually go and see her about, you know, just a few things because she asked me to, was actually you need to tell your staff that when people have pegs fitted, they actually need, you know, instructions about how much they could eat and what sort of diet. You know, you can't just go and eat a sort of great big meal. So there we go. That was that. And then here we are navigating my way to the finish, which when I was rally driving and co-driving and things, that's what we used to do. So I had the radiotherapy for 7 weeks. That was longer than everyone else I met in the department, and I had 6 weeks of chemotherapy. And I didn't like that experience either. I just detested the place. I think I eventually found, it's in three bays, and I found a really nice bay with chaps in. And the rest were all ladies, and they were, and it was my kind of conversation. Sometimes you just want to be on your own, don't you? You know, just don't want that talk, that chatter, that, oh no, don't go on about that. So I found these chaps, and of course, like they liked motorsport like I did. So I was very lucky, towards the end, I had a bay with the same sort of characters in them that I could relate to. So that was good. Yeah, that was good. Okay. So, 7 weeks of chemotherapy, is not nice. We've all been through it. I'm not going to go through all the things that I had wrong with me. But one of the things that these chaps told me was when you have your radiotherapy, take in your own cassettes. And I thought, yeah, that's a good idea. And you can play music you like, because I can't stand this bland, oh, you know what it's like, lift music type music. And I like rock and I like blues and stuff like that. And I'm thinking, right, so I took in Meatloaf. Because when you're there for 10 minutes, pinned down to this awful table, it's pinning down, really, I think, that I hated. You know, and your thoughts start getting a bit dark when you're lying there, I've got to be honest. And 10 minutes is a long time. And, you know, you're kind of like, so I got Meatloaf blaring in my ears and it was just great. I could cope with that. That was good. So really, as everyone knows, it's a horrible, horrible treatment to have to go through, but we're here, and we've made it through so far. I have to say to you that the staff at Torbay, and it is a fantastic team. I know everyone said it, but as a patient who's been through them, through the whole lot, and I'm still having acupuncture, which was great, and I still get seen regularly now by this excellent consultant, Mr. Rees. So, So you cannot say any more. They are just brilliant. And Mr. Singham, who was here this morning talking about acupuncture, does my acupuncture. And it does help. I have to say, it helps. So if you can encourage your own trust or wherever you come from to think about it. Because it doesn't cost a lot of money. A few needles, you know, just a little bit of training. It's anyway, there we go. So I don't want to hold you up, but post-treatment, of course, is a huge learning curve. I'm not going to go through all the long-term effects. I'm now more frightened for 10 years down the line than I was straight after the straight after the effects I had before. I'm lucky. I'm here. And, you know, the carer on the first day said something about people spending time and talking to them, the professionals in the room. And I would like to say that at Torbay, my husband felt like part of the family. They had spoken to him. There was one locum consultant who came, who I saw quite a lot in the clinic, and he had a cracking sense of humour and used to have us in stitches, and he involved my husband Andy, and it was just brilliant. And when we saw the oncology team, the follow-up MTG appointments, the oncologist noticed my husband, he's crazy about Land Rovers. And he had a Land Rover badge in his lapel. So while I was chatting to the team, which are great speech and language therapists, the dietitian, clinical nurse specialist, the oncologist, you know, it's just brilliant. And the oncologist was actually chatting to my husband about Land Rovers. So yeah, that was nice. That was nice for him. And I'm glad that they did. So I can honestly say my experience was that they did involve my husband. And the Land Rover mantra is one life, live it, and that's what I've been doing. So thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you, Denise. So do we have any questions?
Would you recommend having support groups across the board on all trusts?
Oh yes, I mean, part of when I became respectable after I'd been the enemy within, I became a chief executive in local government, and I was a big regionalist. And if you build regionalism from the roots, not from the top, from rooted source, then you become more effective in any organisation. So yeah, we do need these groups throughout the region, throughout the country. That's a short answer. Yes.
Perfect. And Denise, thinking of your journey, yeah. I think something like the Swallows Group. I'm trying to sound like I'm doing an advert here, but Mouth Cancer Foundation or whoever it is, do you think a support group should be embedded within the pathway?
Yes, I do, and I feel that quite strongly because my background's public health and health promotion, and you need to work with communities in prevention and get the message out there. People need to know about Swallows. They need to know about head and neck cancer to start with. And, you know, if I might just say, I think Torbay's head and neck cancer team stand head and shoulders above other specialities, and that is true, and that's how I feel. And other people have said it to me as well. So they need to be, it needs to be as part of the pathway. Yes, definitely. And you need, you need to be around promoting yourselves, but the trust needs to be promoting head and neck cancers. And cancer societies and organisations need to do exactly the same.
I just think if it's embedded in a pathway, then commissioners will look at it more seriously.
Yeah absolutely.
Instead of it being a bolt-on that, is, well, it's a nice tick box. And that's not having to go at any of the teams. I'm talking about commissioners now that control money.
Well, Chris will know. That's why I went to the chair of our trust to get her to come to our launch. We launched in May of this year. If you get the chair, you have then some kind of political appointee saying this should happen. So that was a really positive move to get her going there and supporting us. And she still supports us.
Sorry, I think there was another question.
Hello.
You have a problem with mics, you.
Whoops. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Hello. I'm just so grateful for your stories. Thank you. You know, you are the reason we do what we do.
Bless you.
You know, you're the reason we get up every morning, because we want is to support you and your families.
Thank you.
So, thank you. I do have a question. What advice would you give somebody who's about to have treatment like you had?
Well, I would actually say get in touch with Swallows, people like that who have been through it. I think locally there should be a point of contact where people could talk to someone before they even come into the hospital. You know, if there's some way of this they were talking about pre-radiotherapy rehabilitation, I would say, yeah, definitely. Is there some way you can do a pre-treatment? If it's in primary care or wherever, but you need someone in the community you can connect with and talk to, and I feel very strongly about that, yeah. Yeah.
I would just add, alone is the loneliest word I've ever come across. And if anybody goes into the process alone, I think they're dragging a great big weight along with them. If you can get a caregiver, it doesn't have to be a partner. It can be a friend, it could be a mate, anybody. I mean, the thing about cancer is it's the most... Rod Gilbert's film, have you seen it on Channel 4? And he describes it as the most equal opportunities illness. Because it doesn't matter if you're black, white, if you're gay, straight, male, female, whatever, everybody can cop it, rich, poor. And he describes that on the programme. If you haven't seen it, get it on Channel 4 Play again. Watch it, because he talks about the importance of the support mechanism. So advice to anybody, have a supporter with you.
So what I'd say is, if you don't mind, Laura, is that our 24/7, and we take the course, so me and Sharon take the course, so I know firsthand. When I first started it, people thought that our support groups and our 24/7 should be for survivors when they step over that and the rug's pulled underneath them. Because up to that point, they've got you, they've got absolutely everybody. But on our 24/7, our busiest times normally are on a Saturday and Sunday, or a Wednesday or a Thursday. And that's because most clinics are on a Friday and a Tuesday. So they're being told normally on a Friday that you've got cancer in some of the trusts, and they're told then to go away and think about it and come back on the Tuesday for your pathway. And that's when our phones go in meltdown. So I think, like Sid is saying, from that moment that you step into that room, whoever's going to deliver that message that you've got cancer, our 24/7 number should be on a card that they give them to them and say, from this moment on, ring this number for any questions. We can then reassure them, and they feel then that weight that you're talking about has gone.
Could I just add to that? But very brief comment. I don't want to keep you from winding up. But Swallows has enabled us to have a couple of people for the first time who are just entering the program of treatment, just entering it. And a woman came in tears with her son holding on one side and her daughter-in-law on the other. And I was watching this, and just observing it. And at the end of the process, she came up and gave me a great big smacker on my cheek and said, thanks. Mm. Now, for me, that's like $1 million, you know? But for her, it meant that she's entering something with the confidence of other people saying, hey, we're all here, we'll get through it. And it's a tough gig, but we'll get through it. Sorry.
So for the last 18 months ago, 2 years, I took a call from a patient on the 24/7. And he was a well-spoken gentleman, very well-spoken, worked in London, and he's a barrister. So very well-spoken, understands everything that's going on. But he rang me and he needed support and he just wanted to talk. And most of that conversation, it wasn't even a conversation, it was just, you know, the guys were talking about twitching and I was just saying yes or no, or yes or no. But he got so much from it, and what he told me was, he has to be the brave man in front of everyone. He goes in court, he's a barrister, he seemed to be this big, big, brave, educated man. And he had no escape. His family and everybody saw him as this big, brave man. For 18 months now, most Fridays, around about 9 o'clock, my phone will go and it'll be him. And he talks to me for about half an hour with all his problems. and he offloads that for three, because he has nobody else in the world that he can offload those problems to. And off he then goes back into his big professional land, putting people in prison, doing whatever he does. But that Friday night, he rings us. And I think that's what we all need, that weight. If he didn't have that, what the hell's he going to do? So I think the Swallows, and I'm, you know, I would hope that across the country, at the point that people get diagnosed, they should be given us. Because there is only me and Sharon, but if it's someone from Cornwall, I make sure he gets in touch with them. If it's someone from Worcester, I'll ring up Chris, and I'll say to Chris, I've got a patient in your area, can you give him a contact? If it's someone in London, I would normally try and ring John, and John, if he's got time, will speak to them. If I've got someone that is like yourself, and we've done it, mm-hmm. I'll get Laura to speak to them. I don't deal with them all, because I can't. Mm-hmm. It's impossible. But we've got over 12,000 patients and carers around the globe. There is someone I can put them in touch with that is happy to talk. And most of it isn't talking, trust me, it's listening. And once you listen, people's problems dissolve.
It's a peer-to-peer support, whether you're a patient or a caregiver, that is so crucial from their diagnosis.
So the gap that we have are caregivers. I have enough patients, people like Sid, people like the Johns of this world, the Chris up there, and everyone. I have enough patients. I've now got enough laryngectomies that I can refer. What I don't have are caregivers. Sharon deals with every caregiver that comes on, because we don't have a network of caregivers that are willing to say, well, if you get someone, I'll talk to them. I'll just listen to them. And when you've been through it as a caregiver, I don't know how I didn't get divorced. I don't know how the hell Sharon didn't kick me out and get rid of me, because she went through hell. Yes. And I've done that. I took it out on the one I loved. And I think we all do. Yeah. Mm. So once you've been there, whether you're a man or a lady, you understand the problems from a caregiver. And most of those caregivers' calls, unfortunately, come between 11 at night and 5 in the morning. And I think that's because they've settled their patient down. They've sorted the patient out. The patient's suddenly relaxed or doing whatever that patient is doing. They've stepped out of a room, gone upstairs, or just walked the dog around the block. We get a lot of caregivers that walk a dog around the block at silly hours of the morning. That's frightening enough, thinking that a woman is out in the streets walking in the state they are. But then Sharon picks those calls up. It would be nice that Sharon could take that call and say, do you know what? If you're in Worcester, I've got a caregiver. I'll get a caregiver to give you a call. We would never ask you to go one-to-one because it's dangerous. It's always phone calls. But we would love a network of caregivers. So keep that in mind. And health officials, please, from the moment they get diagnosed, we have to take those weights off people. And I'm sorry I've spoken, but it's important. Over to you.
Any other questions for Sid or Denise?
One more Perfect. We're going to go to... thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Laura. And Laura is an incredible lady as well. One of these days, we're going to get her up here and next year, hopefully, get her to do some recipes in front of everyone. We'll have one of those kitchens where she cooks, because some of her recipes are phenomenal. You need to get the book. So we're going to move on now, and we are now in the last session. So every year, we announce where we're going next year. We keep it a top secret, and we don't do it until this session. And it's important we do that, because two things. One, it keeps you here. Two, all those people that are in the sponsorship room have already signed up for next year, and they don't even know where they're going. So, but they've signed up. But we now announce where we're going. And I think we've got a film, have we not? Go on, keep going. So we are in Sheffield, and I tell you what, big round of applause to John R. Cameron, because he didn't half make a city look good, doesn't he? Philip, do you want to come up? Ali, Paul. So at this stage, what Philip is going to do is officially hand over the presidency to the next two presidents. And please, if you want to just shake hands, do what you want, jump up and down. But Paul, Paul, welcome to obviously the conference next year.
You're the vice president.
Yeah.
You're Kamala Harris.
I
didn't
know. I hope he does a better job than her.
So we are in Sheffield. So we've already started to plan. We started to plan this morning, believe it or not, at 9 a.m. Me and Sharon have already started planning. John, bless him, we always have an opening film, as you know. I have no idea what that opening film's going to be until film day. His remit is to make me look stupid, but he's also had a good go at you, which
cracking job.
Almost, that was good. Every president that's been on this stage when we do it haven't got a clue what they're going to be filmed as next year. So it's your turn. It's your turn, and it's your turn. Anybody have any ideas what Sheffield is famous for? Steel?
Music.
Steel, what?
Music.
Full Monty.
Full Monty. I'm not saying anything, but maybe it's something to do with steel. Or maybe it's something to do with factories, or the university's famous for dentistry. So we're going to bring in dentistry next year, without a shadow of that, because it has to be. And pathology, which is incredible. But I think that maybe you've got some ideas, John, have you? So if you want to laugh next year, be at Sheffield. And if anyone's got any Velcro, they can loan us. So, over to you. Do you want to say some words about next year?
Thanks a lot for coming here. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be hosting it next year. I've been asking Chris for the last few years, and we've got a tough job on our hands with how successful this meeting has been and how many of you have attended, but also to beat the weather. So, I'll start praying for good weather. I was saying to someone, people say Sheffield is the steel city, and that's not just because of the steel, but also because of the colour of the sky.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it is grey most of the time, but it's a lovely city, and really look forward to having you all there. Lots to do, and hopefully we'll highlight and showcase the best that Sheffield has to offer for the patients, for researchers, and for healthcare professionals.
Thank you. Paul, would you like to say a few words? Perfect. It'd be the first time we've had a president and vice president. There are two other ladies. Where are you? Sam and Fahida. Please stand up, Sam, Fahida. So these two ladies came to me and begged me to bring the conference here. And I have to say, we are now getting to the stage where trusts are literally coming to us. I've already got up to about 20, 28 at the moment that people are coming to me and saying they want to do it. But you two begged me, and how can you say no to those two? It's just impossible. And I'm so pleased we fetched it. But these two guys have been instrumental in bringing it here to Torquay through Torbay. And they've obviously, the remit was, make you look stupid, which I refuse. And obviously then, we then go to someone like Philip, who put his hand up and said yes, and then we told him about the opening film. Because he hadn't got a clue, but he'd already said yes and signed the contract. So, but he's been a... Yeah. But he's been a great president. So a big round of applause to Philip. Massive round of applause for Sam and Fahida. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you. And to be fair, Torquay and Torbay staff, all of them have done a massive job to get them as many people here as we have. So, again, a round of applause for all those guys. So, laughter is the best medicine. I would like to finish on a joke, but I'm not a comedian, so I'm not going to do. But laughter is the best medicine. Remember, if you laugh in a room, the most miserable person can be in there, and they'll end up laughing with you. And laughter can get you through anything. It really can. And laughter is one. And it's cheap. It's free. You don't have to have it on prescription. You just have to have an attitude for life. And I think we've all got that attitude for life. Otherwise, we wouldn't be in this room. So please, you know, remember laughter is the best medicine. I need to finish on my team. John, tremendous. Well done. The guys that do the IT and all this stuff, you see, do a great job. They sit behind there. As long as I give them beer and food, they're happy. They sleep underneath as well. They don't even go anywhere. They sit there all the time. So, you know, thanks, guys. You do, and also your team do a phenomenal job. Took them all day to set this up on Monday. You know, it's not a five-minute job. It's phenomenal. where are you? Stand up, please, Ben. Mr. Batman himself, incredible. His wife, Steph, at the back. Stand up. Well done. We've got Phil here, which is Mr. Timekeeper. He retired 3 days ago. So happy retirement. I hope you enjoy retirement.
Thank you for the card.
Even though we're going to get you involved. But he does sit here and does all the timing. I do think, I was saying to his wife, last year he literally is a Trojan on timing. I think since he's retired he's become a bit of a softy, but maybe we'll have the old Phil back next year. Anyway, for all now. So the other ones I need to thank are all our artists around, and I hope you've had a chance to look at some of their work because it's absolutely incredible. They've just painted and drawn what they've seen on stage through their own eyes, and some of the stuff is phenomenal. It really is, and I'm looking forward to putting that into some on the website so everyone can see it. So, guys, thank you very much. And yeah, when I contacted the university, pal, stand up. That man comes straight back to me and said he would love his students to be involved. A lot of students get projects and they're pretend projects. He had took the opportunity to give them a real project to work on, and I hope they get a lot back from it, pal, and I hope they go on to bigger and better things, so thank you. So we have a board of trustees. One of them is stood there, David, one of our trustees. The other trustees are more helicopter trustees, which I don't mind because then I haven't got to listen to them twerping in my ear. But this guy joined us this year and he's been phenomenal. He does an awful lot for the Swallows. He sits in the background. He doesn't do a lot in standing up here. But again, thank you from my heart. You've been incredible. And she's not in the room because she won't be. But my wife, Sharon. So yeah, so she's phenomenal. She's behind everything. You know, I come up with these stupid ideas about making you look silly. I'm going to make you certainly look silly. And then these guys all make it happen. But Sharon's always behind making sure everything works to a clock. And she is the brains behind absolutely everything. And she's the organizer. She does absolutely everything for me. And, you know, 7 weeks ago with a heart attack, I'm still here today because of her. So, you know, I love her to death and I will do for the rest of my life. And that's important to me that she gets the recognition, even though she disappears every time. So, but for me, you know, the conference is now finished. I hope you have a safe journey home. I hope you've enjoyed it. You can't please everybody all the time, but I hope I've pleased everybody in certain parts. And I hope you've had a lot from it. I hope you've learned something, and I hope you've shared, and I hope you've made lots of friends. Tommy got the film, and it made a massive difference to him. He cannot believe that we'd done that just for Tommy, and he got it just as he came out. So, you know, that's what it's all about. So thank you very much, guys. I do now, unless you want to say anything else.
Only to Chris, the man in front of the brains of the outfit. he's the guy who's, you know, who with Sharon obviously has got all this together over years gone by and many years to come.
Everything speaks for itself, so there's little point in crapping on, but Chris is the front and the mouth of the organisation, but more than that, and he's why we're here. You know, there's no swallows without him. So
thank you.
So
thank you.